So thanks, Nikki, for joining us on the Indian Tennis Daily official platform for this Insta Live. My name is Harish Ramchandani. For those who are not familiar with me, this is my first time doing an Insta Live with ITD. So thank you for the opportunity. So Nikki, just to start off with, people in the Indian tennis circles are quite familiar with you, and you've been a national champion in India as well. But maybe you can start off by telling us about your background in terms of how you got started off with tennis as a kid, what kind of drew you to the sport?
Yeah, definitely. First of all, it's a pleasure to be with ITD again, doing a live. So they're doing an incredible job with news around the world. So thanks to ITD first. And second, so my childhood is pretty much simple. Like, my dad and my mom both were a sportsman. So they were into sports. So I didn't have any trouble, like, staying outside the house. So in fact, like, they're okay with me going to the ground, like skipping the school and going to the ground. So they didn't mind that.
Oh,
So
that's nice.
yeah. So I started playing really young, like just playing all the sports, not just tennis. I used to play football,
Okay.
athletics, all this kind of stuff. And then I slowly got into tennis. My dad was a tennis coach back then. So he
Okay.
learned tennis just to teach me, and then I was yeah, the spring, I think probably I started first tournament when I was like 9 years or 10 years old. I was like playing the first tournament, and then like after that it started pretty good. I just my dad saw potential and he made me play tennis, like fully focused on tennis, so it was really good. And then slowly I went into juniors and so on.
Okay. So did you play a lot of the junior circuit in India and abroad as well? Or how was the junior experience like? Did you get a lot of exposure to the junior circuit in India and the ITF junior circuit abroad?
Actually, so I play a lot of national tournaments. I because back then I came from a very small town, and people didn't know, didn't have the knowledge of tennis, like how the tennis runs, the tournaments, the ranking, everything. So by the time I
Okay.
got to know, okay, there is something called ITF Juniors, and it was pretty good, pretty much played. Like, I got to know around like when I was like 16, something like that.
Okay.
So I was playing a lot of juniors, but like all this NSCS, I used to
Okay.
play everything all over in India. But then the ITF events, I think I played like close to 12 in the whole career. I think that's it.
Okay.
I didn't travel pretty much. I think in juniors I just went to Sri Lanka once, if I'm not wrong. So that's the only
Okay.
international travel I did for an ITF. Apart from that, I didn't have much experience in the ITF circuit.
Okay. And then moving on to the nationals at the senior national levels in India, like how was that transition from the juniors to the national senior circuit? I believe at that time there were quite a few more tournaments at the national level compared to now because of obviously the pandemic and all. So how was that experience in terms of traveling around India and playing the national tournaments out there?
Yeah, it was pretty good. Like, I was pretty good in doubles back then, compared to singles. But it was really good. The level was good. I didn't do much in the nationals of, like, for example, Adidas Nationals or in the Fenestar Nationals in juniors. I think the best was I made doubles runner-up in Adidas Nationals, I think, under 18. And
Okay.
then even in Fenestar Nationals juniors, I was, I think, the best performer was like quarter. So, but I didn't pretty much play those things. But it was good. I think I played one men's when I was a junior, when I was like under 17, and sorry, under 18. I was
Okay.
like 17 years old, so I played one men's, the Fenestar men's qualifying. Yeah, I mean, I lost in, I think, final qualifying. So that was a pretty good chance for me to see how the Indian level of main players are. So it was pretty good back then.
Okay. And then you also mentioned earlier that you were from a small town, and I read somewhere that you were from Anandpur in the south. Is that correct?
No, Anantapur is where I live now. My parents are held up
Okay.
now, but I was born and brought up in Neyveli, so that's in Tamil Nadu.
Okay.
It's closer to
So I was
Coimbatore.
asking actually. Okay. Actually, I was asking about Anandpur because I know there's a Rafa Nadal Tennis Academy there where they have their charity. I think the foundation kind of has a center there. So have you had a chance to visit that center, and what is it like out there in that center?
I've been there like twice, but I didn't go there to play, but I just went there to see the
Okay.
facilities and stuff. And they do more of charity work. It's not a professional training center. They teach all
Okay.
the kids
Right.
computer education. They provide all
Okay.
the equipments, and they even conduct tournaments sometimes for the local awareness. So it's
Okay.
pretty good out there. Like, what the foundation is doing is pretty solid there.
Okay. And then moving on in your career, I think 2019, at the end of 2019, you won the Indian National. So how was that movement from like being one of the, like you mentioned, you were better in doubles early on, but then moving from there to becoming the national champion in the Indian national champion. So how was that kind of experience?
It was good. So that tournament gave me a lot of confidence in terms of game-wise, my strokes and everything. So I was trying out new stuff, new strokes. Back then, I was correcting a lot of things, a lot of improvements. So that week had a big impact on how I saw things after that. How I should play a game. I became a little bit more mature on the court, on how to play certain points and everything. So it was a good experience, like overall, because I think everyone knows I wasn't 100% physical for that week. But then I was mentally there. I was mentally fighting every day. I was there to win. So I think it gave me something real which I haven't experienced before, so that was really great.
Okay, we have a question from Kaushik on the chat. He's asking, who is your favorite tennis player?
I mean, Roger Federer.
Roger Federer.
Yeah.
Okay, no, not Djokovic or Nadal.
I mean, I like Djokovic, but yeah, I mean, like, favorite player is still Roger.
Okay, so what do you think of his chances this time at Wimbledon? Do you think he's going to get far into the final weekend?
I really hope so. I'm waiting. Yeah,
It's all right.
really hope so.
I'm a big Federer fan as well, so I'm hoping that he gets to the final as well. So I'm cheering for him as well.
Yeah, I really hope he wins one more Grand Slam.
Yeah, same here. Okay. And then you mentioned like when you won the nationals in India in 2019, you've also been playing a lot of ITF events. How is the experience or the competition different at an India level as compared to when you travel to the ITF World Tour events across? Is there a significant difference in terms of the level of competition? What do you think about that?
Yeah, that's true. So I think when I started playing men, I was in Spain for a few years, like 1 2 years I was there. So I was playing a lot of tournaments over there. So the level is definitely different. I would say India have great players, like the top players are really good. But over there, even the unranked player, for example, the guy I played in the qualifying, he didn't have a rank, but he played pretty like a solid game because they are trained. Even the normal kid, I mean, even the unranked player trains like 5 to 6 hours a day. Even the juniors, like
Okay.
14 years old, they train every day.
Okay.
But I think now it's changing in India. Now we have even more much better players coming up, and the standard is going up.
Okay. I'll just pause for 1 minute here and tell those people who've tuned in that if you have any other questions for Nikki, please feel free to make a comment and we'll try to get them across to him during the next half an hour or so. And then you mentioned like after that, the last year has been very tough for everybody because of the pandemic and things have stopped. So I think like just when you were starting to improve on your singles game. Things have really kind of gone haywire for everybody in the tennis world. So, how have you been keeping yourself busy during that time when tournaments are not happening? And, you know, how do you maintain that, the match fitness, your physical fitness, your mental toughness and all that?
I mean, it's really tough. Like, the physical fitness went down. I think it's normal because we were in a quarantine. There wasn't much of activity throughout the day, so the physical fitness will definitely go down. But I think mentally, I was ready to perform after the lockdown is over. Like, even though it's had to start from the start, but I thought like it's a new beginning. It's a new day every day, so I just kept playing. The only goal was to improve, because we got even now I have like 1 month. I gave myself 1 month time for the tournament, so I'm gonna do whatever I can, improve as much as I can in this 1 month, so I can do better in the upcoming tournaments.
Okay. And recently you won an ITF tournament in Delhi in March when they had a series of ITF tournaments. So that must have been a good morale booster as well.
Yeah, definitely. Like, since the first COVID hit, there was a break for like 6 to 7 months. After that, I came back, got a bit injured. So it took me nearly like 3 months to start playing a tournament, but then I didn't do much good. I lost six in a row, like six first rounds in a row. After that, I won a tournament. So that's pretty good for me. My confidence was back, but again, the COVID came, the lockdown started. So then let's hope that I'll do the same in the upcoming tournaments as well.
Sure. Just one question. Another question that came up is, why are Indians not able to win singles Grand Slams? I think that's a question that I think a lot of Indian fans have. And after winning a lot of doubles Grand Slams, we are not able to kind of have that same success in singles. So, any thoughts on that?
I mean, there's not much of to say there. Everybody's working hard. Everybody's working towards to win a Grand Slam. Eventually, all the players are working towards that. I think in a couple of years, I think we can definitely see Indian winning Grand Slam soon, the singles especially. So I really hope for that.
Okay. There's an interesting question here from, I think, Samrida. She says, I'm assuming that's a lady. She says, I had to give up my game because of society and house pressures, and I'm around 20 years old now. And I want to join again. How can I start? Is it possible for it to be my main profession? So, any thoughts on that, Nikki? Any words of advice to Samrida?
I mean, you can definitely start. Tennis is not like a fixed age game. You can definitely start playing. You can definitely improve much. Being a main profession, it's again up to the personal desire, the house support. Like everything comes in place. If everything goes well, I think it can become a main profession. But I think first of all, you have to play the game. You have to enjoy to play the game every day. It doesn't matter about the results. You keep working hard, and eventually you can gain something out of it.
Yeah, I mean, that just reminds me of some of those questions. Reminds me of Kimiko Date, the former Japanese player who I think she retired at 26 and then took a 12-year break. And at 38, she started to come back and made even started playing Grand Slam. So, I mean, she obviously had the right support, of course, in terms of financial support and house support and
Right.
the training support and all that. So, it's definitely possible if all the other things come into place.
Definitely.
Okay, great. You also mentioned you're currently training and you're now planning for tournaments to take part after a month. So, I mean, what's your plan? Where are you planning to play, in India or abroad? What's your schedule like for the next few months?
India, I don't think as of now there's gonna be ITF events happening, because they're gonna start with juniors first. I think the ITF is gonna start with juniors first, and then eventually, I hope there's gonna be ITFs coming in like another 3 4 months if there is no COVID lockdown anymore. But then the most plan is to for Egypt or Tunisia. I think Tunisia is is there like every week there is one tournament happening. So mostly Tunisia, if possible Egypt also.
Okay.
So that's the plan so far.
Okay. And I believe you're currently training, I mean, you've been training over the past recent times at the Rohan Bopanna Tennis Academy in Bangalore.
Yeah.
So can you just tell us about your experience there and maybe also talk about Rohan? He's currently at Wimbledon. I'm sure he spent a lot of time at the academy when he's not on tour. So what's it like having somebody who's that experienced and successful on the international circuit as probably a mentor and somebody to guide everybody around out there? What is that like?
Yeah, I mean, Rohan is one of the nicest person you can ever meet in a tennis circuit, I mean, in life in general. So he is down to earth, like he's always willing to help with no matter what. If you have a doubt, any doubt regarding tennis or in life, you ask him, he's there. He's always replies. So he cares a lot. And he took a special interest in his academy. He wants this center to be mainly for professional players and not just academy where it opens and shut down in like few years. So he made a lot of effort. And now we have Balu sir, Prajnesh coach. So he's working with us in the academy. And we have Sujit. And we have excellent fitness trainer, Chelston, and Abhi and Drew. And we have like amazing facilities. I think the sports school. So they have, it's like amazing facilities. Everything is there. Perfect for a tennis player, I would say, in India as of now. Even the training schedule is perfectly planned. It is actually planned by Rohan, sort of. Even he gets involved in the training session, what needs to be done. He reviews all the players whenever he gets a chance. He always keeps an eye on the academy. So I think the academy wise is really good. He wants it to be a main hub for Indian players. I think any Indian can, like all the top. I think even Prajnesh was there for a couple of weeks in the academy. Even Mukund came, Sriram Balaji, Riya Bhatia. So all of them were there for practicing. So it's a really good center. If anybody's looking to train professionally, I think it's a definitely good place to start.
Sure. We have a couple of questions on the training centers. Vandana is asking, what is the best advice that you got from Rohan? If you can share that with us.
Rohan, best advice is you gotta keep your opponent guessing. So. I mean, especially, I think he's known for his serve. He has a good, very huge serve.
Yeah.
So the one thing he always reminds me of is like, you have to keep your opponent guessing. It doesn't matter which stroke, especially serve. So he said, you know, go T, go second serve, you can go T, or you can go body. Like, you have to keep your opponent guessing. So I think so far that's the best advice I got from Rohan in terms of tennis.
Okay. Anything outside tennis that you want to share as well? Any advice outside tennis?
Nothing much outside tennis. He'll be like, go enjoy yourself. So,
okay.
Yeah. He's cool in that, yeah.
A couple of other questions. One, somebody asked, I didn't get that name, but somebody asked if they have a boarding facility at the academy. Where is it a residential program or is it somebody who... you just have to go and stay outside the academy when you just go there to train for the day and come back?
No, they have a boarding as well. They have a hostel service in the facility itself. And if not, they can arrange. If you're not comfortable with the hostel, then they can arrange for something outside also. They have a hostel mess, everything inside the campus.
Okay. Another question on the training center was the difference between training. I think everybody hears a lot about the difference between training centers in India and abroad. You also mentioned you were in Spain for a while, so you would have seen the training centers there. And now we have a couple of good ones like I think there's one by Sania Mirza as well in Hyderabad, one by Rohan Bopanna as well as some other ones by the AIT as well. So what do you think of the standard of facilities here as compared to abroad?
I mean, 6 years back, I would say there's a lot of difference because the coaches weren't that educated before, but now there are pretty good academies happening in India, like Rohan and then Sania Misra. There's one in Ahmedabad, and there's one in Delhi. So a lot of academy came up now in recent years. Now I think there is not much of difference. It's just comes to the knowledge of coach. So the facility-wise, everything is there. Even the coaching-wise, everything is there. Few things change, but I think we are getting there.
Okay. Another question related to, I mean, not related to this, but somebody was asking, how do you recover yourself after a match? Like in terms of physical fitness, what do you do? What is your recovery plan like after a match?
Recovery is first get hydrated well after a match. After a match, you definitely lose a lot of electrolytes and everything. So first, you have a lot of water, electrolytes, then stretch, then rehab. Because for me, rehab is a big part of my life and tennis. I have to do to be ready fit for tomorrow match. So yeah, I think drink, eat, sleep, and then rehab, and again rest. So pretty much the same every day for me.
Sure. You also had some difficult times with injuries in your career. So can you just tell us, I mean, how is your physical fitness at this point? I mean, rehab is obviously a part of most athletes' life, but do you have to spend more time on it than as compared to other pros at your level?
Yeah, definitely. I have to at least spend like an hour of just the rehab part. And then I have to spend, I'm spending more time in stretching in the morning routines, like yoga. I think in a day I would spend yoga, stretching, and everything comes to like close to 2 hours a day in the morning and the evening combined. Because before I had some injuries, but then now it became aggravated. Like I have a little bit back issue and wrist. Few things comes up, and so I have to keep myself fit. So I think rehab is I have to do. I'm doing more than any player, I think, at my level.
Okay. One other question: which is your favorite surface to play on?
As from Shivam, I think. I haven't tried grass court, so I'm not sure how it feels. So as of now, hard court.
Okay. I think we'll move on to another topic that I wanted to discuss is on the ITF World Tour Player Panel. Last year, you were one of the players who was selected on the ITF World Tour Player Panel. It was a newly formed panel, I believe, in the last couple of years. And there are some very significant personalities like Mark Woodforde and Mary Pierce who were associated with at the time. So if you can just tell us what exactly does the panel do? What is your role in it? I mean, how do you all meet? Is it virtual? Just a little bit about the ITF panel as well.
Yeah. So we, of course, we meet virtual, like video call. So we have meetings with the ITF, even with the president sometimes. So he'll be on the call. 2 months once, I would say there'll be a meeting regarding all the issues going on, all the topics we want to talk. The role is to find out what the player wants. It's mainly the connection between the players and the ITF heads. So the player, we find anything troubling. If a player wants to get something from the officials, for example, there have been a lot of incidents about the visa, the new regulations, the COVID regulations, the tournament changed few rules. So there were a lot of issues going on there. So we would get back to the ITF and they'll be solved within like a day or so. And then we are pushing for a few rules change, the points change, and even the doubles is going to change. The entry is going to change now in some time. And then we are trying to push the ATP points, like, because the ITF is not giving much of ATP points now. the 15 case and 25 case now, and it's really, really tough for a player to transit to ATP challenger level. So we are trying to push that, and we spoke to ATP vice chairman, and then we're going to have a meeting soon, so something will come up definitely. I really hope so.
Okay. And I think this topic has really come about in the media over the last year and all, when people have really talked about the difficulties in terms of financially sustaining a tennis professional career. Like, I think some report I read said only 100 to the top 100 or 150 people at the most in the rankings make break even. The rest of them are paying out of their pocket or either their parents or their sponsors. They're not really making money. So it must have been a struggle for you as well in terms of having the financial support to sustain or to actually pursue a career, first of all, and then sustain it over a longer period of time.
That is true. I mean, for a tennis player, it's really tough. As you said, that only top 100 or 80, they make a living in tennis. Other than that, people are just barely breaking even. And people are, like, the players rank around, like, 600, 500. They don't even break even. Like, we go on a loss every year. So that has to change. I think hopefully ATP and ITF can do something about it. So it is there. Like, that is the struggle every tennis player has and will have for a couple of years, I guess. And then hopefully something will come up and some program can change things.
Sure. And related to that, of course, there's another association, the Professional Tennis Players Association, PTPA, which has a lot of major names like Djokovic and Pospisil, who have started this association with a view on similar lines, where they want to improve the playing conditions for players, maybe more prize money and things like that. So one is, what are your thoughts on that? And second is, are these two bodies working together, like in terms of, do you all talk to the PTPA people and try to figure out how you can work together in these kind of areas?
I mean, PTPA is, I think a lot of players are associated with it. I think even Sumit is there and even Rohan is there, if I'm not wrong. I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah.
But it's good. Like, any organization willing to help the players is really good. I would appreciate if the organization can come up with something if it helps the players. And I mean, we are not directly associated with the organization, but some of the members, the ITF members, the player panel members, have a contact to Novak or his coach or big players. So we get information now and then, but we haven't really spoken to them as a member to the organization yet. So I think maybe we can give it a try. It does no harm, so maybe probably we can do that.
Okay. There are a couple of very persistent comments on the chat, so I'm just going to ask you to comment to them. One was, I saw two or three questions about the best academy in Delhi. You mentioned an academy in Delhi, so if somebody is looking for a couple of good academies in Delhi, which ones would you recommend?
I think, I'm not sure the academy name, but there is one with Yuki's coach, and then there is one in Todd Clark. I think it's outside Delhi, if I'm not wrong. Not sure of the academy name, but I think these two coaches can definitely help you out. I think the Todd Clark is a good coach. He's been there in India for, I don't know, close to 6-7 years. He's been here in India training. He's an Australian, so he's a pretty good coach. Definitely can help players.
Sure. There's also, I think, Raghu, who's telling you to say hi. I mean, to say hi to him.
Hello, Raghu. Definitely. Alvin.
Okay. And there was
Alvin Grassler.
And there was another question from another, I think, a tennis aspirant, who said, if I'm 18 years old, can I join an academy and pursue this as a professional career, similar to something, I think, that you mentioned earlier. So I think the response would probably be the same, that it would be possible, I guess.
First you have to play tennis, you have to learn, you have to enjoy the sport. If everything falls in place, then it will automatically take you to the professional level.
Let's talk a few minutes besides tennis now. So I believe off the court you have some other stuff going on as well. One of them I believe was an entrepreneurial venture called SafeBee. So if you can tell us about that and whether it's still an active venture and just throw some light on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that started during the first lockdown. Me and a couple of friends, two more friends, we started this just to make something out of, something for us in terms of being just sitting at home. We can do something. So we started that. Then it went into food business, but unfortunately, I came out of it. During November, December time, because I started playing tennis, I thought, I'll focus more on tennis since I had a lot of injuries going on. I couldn't spend a lot of time with them, so I thought it would be better for me to come out. But the company is still there. They're doing pretty good job now. They have more products and they're doing pretty much, yeah.
And then besides tennis, like when you're not training, when you're not traveling to play tournaments, how do you de-stress? How do you deconnect from tennis and maybe have some fun or chill out? Well, like what do you like to do outside of the courts?
Outside of the court, it's mostly movies. I like to watch series, movies, the typical one. But then apart from that, I love playing games, PS4. I bought one, but again, I sold it. So I'm looking to buy one more soon. And then probably
Are
I'll
you
start.
looking to buy the PS5 now?
PS5 is too expensive and it's tough to get. I recently asked, the people are selling it like 1 lakh. They're buying for 50K and selling for 1 lakh. I said, I'm not going to spend that much for a gaming console as of now. So, yeah.
Okay. There's another question from Shivam who is saying, how important do you think the junior circuit is to help a player transition into the pro tour?
I mean, playing juniors is as important as the transition. We have to play a lot of juniors, especially ITF juniors. Playing in India, I think after you play 1 year in India, you're going to play pretty much the same opponent every tournament. So I think it's really important that you start playing outside India, mainly ITF. So I think once you can get to top level in ITF, like top rank in ITF, I think you'll be in a certain level where you can compete with the men's players. So I think pretty much if you can reach like top 100, top 80 in ITF juniors, so that's a pretty good chance you can do well in ITF men's. I think now in ITF 15K, they have spots for junior players. I think they have two or three spots for junior players. So if you're ranked, I saw, I think pretty much if you're ranked top 80 something, if you apply for ITF, you went through, you get into the main draw through your junior rank. So I think that's pretty good for a junior. And then so playing junior ITF is pretty good also.
Okay, there's another question. I can't get the name correctly, but they're talking about what is the daily schedule for an aspiring pro. So maybe you can just talk about your own daily schedule in terms of when you're playing tournaments and all that. Like, what's the daily schedule like for a tennis pro?
I mean, so my day starts, we start fitness at 8:30, and then we start tennis by 9:45. It goes till 12, and then again we start at 2 o'clock tennis, and then till 3:30, and then 4 to 5 or 3:30 to 4:30 we do again fitness. Then we do cool down, stretching and everything. So that's pretty much 5 to 6 hours a day spending on court, I would say. Apart from that, I do my own things in the morning, yoga, meditation, and then in the evening again stretching. So pretty much, I think 7 to 7.5 hours will go in tennis.
And there was another question, I think, in terms of we were talking about juniors and moving to the pros, also about the college route, where people go to college circuit in the US mainly, or in other developed countries, and then use that to come into the pro tour. So, any thoughts on that as to whether it's a good option for somebody who is starting out to go onto the pro tour?
I wouldn't say no because I'm not completely aware of how things works there. Because I had an opportunity to go to US, I think for Wake Forest, I think when I finished my 12th, but then I didn't take it because back then again there wasn't much of awareness to it, not much of people there. So I didn't choose that, but now I think pretty much a lot of players are going to US. They want to play there, the atmosphere there. So everything is different over there. Like the college tennis is completely different compared to what you play in twos. And then once you're in US, I think there are a lot of tournaments around in US where you can play ITF, ATP. A lot of Indians are doing that. For example, Siddhant Bhatia now is, I think, in Tunisia. He's doing pretty good. I think he won two doubles, or one double, or two runner-up, I think. So he's doing pretty good. So like that. So there is an option for it. And now people are more aware of college tennis and how to properly use the college tennis. So I think even that is a good opportunity if you're looking at the college tennis as well. But both has pros
Okay.
and cons, so it's a personal decision.
Right. You were talking about Siddhant and his double success. I just wanted to get your comments on some of the stuff happening on Twitter today about Leander Paes and Mahesh Bhupathi. Did you get a chance to see what they were tweeting about today?
No, I think I
Okay.
read something like the pairing they did few years back, and they want to do again, something like that.
I mean, it was a bit cryptic, but they were tweeting about a possible comeback. So everybody on
Yeah.
Twitter was going crazy in terms of whether they'll actually make a comeback to play doubles together, which obviously as an Indian fan would be great. But I mean, that would be great. What are your thoughts if they actually did come back and play together?
I mean, that would be amazing. Like, they were the greatest pair in doubles, so it'll be good to see them playing again in Grand Slams and everything, so looking forward to it.
Sure. There's another question, a slightly detailed question. How has the pandemic hit the morale of the Indian tennis community and at the national and ITF level?
I think a lot of players quit tennis after the pandemic. Even during the pandemic, I know a lot of people, they're struggling mentally because there's not much of opportunity in India. Like everything is shut for like almost 1.5 years. And then people are thinking like, should I start again? Should I come back again? Because the age is there for every Indian, there is an age. Once you cross 25, 26, the society will be like, or even your own parents will think like, what are you gonna do? What's your daily income? Like, what are you gonna do after life? You're not gonna just play tennis. So this lot of things happen, and I know a lot of people have quit, not just in India, even abroad. So it's not so good. But then few people came back strong. Few people did work strong, and they did come back better than before. So yeah. So that's really sad to see that's happening. I think ITA has to do something about it, and even the ITF and ATP have to do something about it. I think recently,
Okay.
like during the pandemic, ATP did provide funds to the players.
Yeah.
I think some players, but again, they left out half the players. Like, I think players above 650, they didn't get much. I mean, they didn't get anything, or 700 above. So that's half the population of tennis. I think it would be nice if they can support them as well. But again, it depends on pros and cons. I'm not sure about that, but yeah.
You also mentioned, like, in terms of parents in Indian society asking about, you know, what are you going to do on a longer term basis? Earlier, you mentioned in terms of your parents, they were very, very into sports and always into sports. So, do you face that kind of pressure from them, or are they quite supportive in terms of your pursuing your tennis career?
I mean, no. Like, they are totally supportive even now. So, the one thing I can do properly in my life is tennis. So, I think they said, it's your life, and they want me to play tennis. But I'm going to get a little bit support from, I'm getting a little bit support from the academy, from Rohan as well. And probably I'll be looking to join army or the railways, just as a support in my life, just for the financial support. So it's going to be there. But yeah, I'll be playing tennis. So there's no pressure from my family.
That's great. I wish more parents were like that, not only in India, but across the world.
Yeah.
One question here from Sushank is, can you talk about how you strategize before a match?
Before a match, I'll talk with my coach. So there's going to be a few points for me. If my coach knows the opponent, he's going to tell me some tips. Not much, like very minimal things that I have to focus. I have to be aware of what he's going to do. And I'll be working a strategy with my own thing, with my coach. So I'll be following the own same strategy throughout the week. It's not going to change. I'll be talking to the coach, then have some strategy there, some game style which I want to do. So I'll be doing that, and as well as the things I have to be aware of my opponent.
Okay. Can you talk about your coaches, Balu sir and Sujit? You mentioned them, they're at the academy. So can you just talk about the support that they give you, and how long have you been with them in terms of working with them?
Sujit, I think Sujit was with the Rohan Academy since it started in KSLTA. So I think I've been working with him for close to 3 years now. And Balu sir, I think I started working with him for a couple of months before the pandemic. So both are really good. Both are really different. Balu sir is more into tactical, like on tennis, and Sujit is more on the mental side of tennis. So when I talk to Balu sir, he'll give me things I have to follow while hitting a shot, what I should focus on the opponent, what my opponent is going to do, and everything. Sujit is more on like mental side. Like, don't give up. You should be there. Don't let yourself down. So it is pretty good motivation from both of them.
Okay, we saw a couple of questions, including the last one, I think, about diet. In terms of following a diet for yourself and for tennis, any specific things that you do that you avoid, or that you, what kind of diet do you have?
I mean, for me, I live alone here, not alone with my friends, so it's not 100%. I can't follow a diet because I can't cook much. I don't want to cook, tiring, so I don't cook. So I eat regular things. There's nothing specific, but I try not to eat junk a lot. Sundays exception, but then I try to avoid chips, biscuits now and then. Even the cool drinks, I don't drink much. But during the tournament, it's different. I eat certain food before a match. I prefer the same food every day. I don't mind. So that's different during tournaments. And in terms of diet, I do follow some. Not a specific diet, but I restrict a few things, avoid a few things.
You mentioned that your cheat day is Sunday. So what was today's cheat meal?
Today was biryani.
Oh, biryani, wow. Cool. There's another question which says if you had to start your journey afresh, anything that you would do differently based on your experience so far?
I mean, I wouldn't do anything different, but there was a time for me, I wasted like 2 years, 2 to 3 years, my tennis career when I was 20 till 2023, 22, because I didn't have a base. I was just training myself because I couldn't go back to Spain. We had some financial difficulties, so I couldn't go back to Spain, and I didn't have much knowledge where to train in India. There wasn't like a
Right.
proper setup. So those 2 years just went by that, playing just tournaments, playing myself. I couldn't do anything. After that, Rohan Academy came, so I think that really helped my game.
Okay. So I think we have about 10 minutes left to go to the hour. So any last final questions you guys have, please? And so have you been following Wimbledon this year, and what are the kind of matches, what are your favorites that are kind of for this year's tournament?
Sorry.
I said talk about Wimbledon this year. Have you been following the matches, and who do you think is going to win the titles at Wimbledon this year?
I mean, I have a feeling that Novak is going to win, but then I want
Okay.
the Roger to win, so let's just see.
And what about the women? Who are you rooting for in the women?
Women's son, I mean, Serena was out. Sad, I think she got an injury. Apart from that, I didn't really follow men's. I didn't have time.
Okay.
Even men's, I'm not following that much. I'm just watching match. If I have time, I'll just go into Hotstar and look for some matches. So yeah, not like keen to follow Wimbledon, but yeah, women's I'm keeping an eye, so I'm not especially sure like what's happening in women's and men's as well. Mixed
Sure.
doubles, I'm rooting for Serena and Tanya.
We all are. I mean, I hope they win.
Yeah.
Any plans for you to play mixed doubles in the future, and who would you like to play mixed doubles with if you had the chance?
I mean, as of now, I would say Sanya,
Okay.
but let's see. Other than that,
Any global player that you would like to play at?
yeah, I mean, I want to try it with Serena Venus Williams.
Wow.
Yeah, let's.
She played with Nick Kyrgios this year, so never know,
Yeah,
at the US Open maybe.
maybe or some
Yeah.
like both any Williams. Or Venus,
Okay.
let's see.
Okay. There's another question from Kaushik. I think Euro 2020 is on, UEFA 2020. Are you following football? Are you a football fan?
I mean, kind of not like I don't follow it every day.
Okay.
I
Okay,
just
so any
follow it
favorite
once.
footballers, or are you rooting for any particular team at
I
Euro?
was rooting for Portugal, but then unfortunately they're
Okay.
out. So I support for Ronaldo, so he's out. So I'm not sure what's happening now. Who's winning? Any idea?
I unfortunately don't follow football, but I know that I think England won. They reached the semi-finals.
Okay.
I think Denmark reached the semi-finals.
Ah, nice.
Besides that, I'm not sure, to be honest. I don't follow football much myself. Okay.
Ah, very good.
I'm just looking to see if there are any final questions from the people who've tuned in. Life on Pro Tour can be adventurous. What is the funniest or weirdest experience that you have had while traveling?
So once I traveled to Spain, it was a 36 hours travel. But then when I think it was through Saudi. So when I got into the airport, the officials came and took my passport. They didn't say anything and they were all scary. And I think I was back then, I was like 18 years old. So I didn't know what to do. I was there. So the layover was, I think, pretty much close to 15, 16 hours or 12 hours, something like that. So they took
okay.
my passport and they gave it back almost after like 7 hours. And they didn't say, I asked why and there was no reply. Like they looked at me and like, I was like, okay, thank you for the passport and I left. And I didn't want
Did you ever find out? Did you ever find out later what was the reason?
No, okay. I asked that... why, but they said, sir, please sit, we'll get back to you. When they got back, I asked for what? I asked why did you take the passport? And they said, nothing. They just said, have a safe flight. They just left. So I thought, okay, maybe I shouldn't ask more questions. I want
yeah, you don't want to invite trouble.
Yeah, exactly. I just want to get a Spain, so.
Okay. There's another question about your experience in Spain. How was your experience in Spain when you were there?
It was good. Overall, the culture, the food, I really love the food. Everything was good. The city was beautiful, the Alicante. And the training was pretty intense. Everything was great about Spain. I would definitely love to go back again.
Okay. And you mentioned like your upcoming tournaments are in Tunisia and probably Tunisia or Egypt, right?
Correct. Yeah.
And then any plan? I mean, so you plan to keep traveling then and play more tournaments through the rest of the year of the year?
Definitely. Like tournaments is one is missing from my schedule as of now. Think I'll try to play as many tournaments as possible, keeping my fitness there, and I'll play a lot of tournaments.
Okay. There's another question. Is it okay to start tennis at 17? You already answered that.
You can start playing tennis whenever you want. It's good. It's absolutely easy.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Any final comments, Nikki, on anything else before we tune out?
I mean, nothing much to say about my life, but our reality, the ITD is doing a great job. Thank you for all
Correct.
The newses, all the coverages on Indian players. So I think they get much more love and support. So thank you. Thank you, Harish, for... conducting this, organizing this meeting and live. So it was really good experience for me.
Sure. And I'd also like to thank the Indian Tennis Daily platform because I used to follow them a lot whenever like I wanted to have any player results about India in whichever corner of the world they're playing. They'd always have the scores and they do a great job. And it's just a bunch of people who are doing this in their spare time because they love tennis. So.
Definitely.
And I'm very thankful that they've given me this opportunity as well to come on their platform and have a live show with you. So it's been great, Nikki. All the best for your upcoming tournaments. And hopefully we'll see you lift a lot more titles in the near coming few months.
Definitely, definitely. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thanks, Nikki. Thanks, everybody, for joining.
Definitely.
Thanks. Bye. Good night.
Good night.